Hi everyone, welcome back. So in the last tutorial we talked about the Brownian motion and how to simulate two-dimensional Brownian motion in Excel sheet. So in this tutorial we will talk about the drift. How can we add a drift to a particle? Or a Brownian motion of a particle. So let's define drift in the x direction. So drift. So for the x direction we define drift to be let's say 1 right now, and for y direction also we say it 1. So drift for x, and this is for y, and then I say drift. So now if we have to add this drift, all I need to do is in these steps, so as I should label them, because some of you might not have looked at the previous tutorial. So this is our random steps. So random steps, and this is our dx, which is the random step in a x direction, and this is our dy, and so let's do this. And so, and this one is our position x, and this is our position y. Oh, sorry, I should not say 0 here, I should say here position x and position y. And so what we are doing is that we are using a random number to generate a random step, which is between 0 and minus 1 and 1. And then we are adding these steps together to come up with a random walk. So the particle is moving randomly in the x direction and y direction. So now how will we add drift to this? So to define the random walk, we added the random step to the initial position. So initial position was 0 and 0, the particle start from origin, and then we add random walk of delta x. So now here all we have to do is we have to add the drift into it, and then we have to put a dollar sign so that it always refer to cell G2 and doesn't change the reference as we move in the other cells. And same way for the y, we have to add the drift of y and say dollar sign here. And now as you can drag it down, you see that all the reference cell changed, my initial position changed, the random step changed, but the drift remained same because I put a dollar sign here. So now I can just select these two cell and double click on this one, and as you can see now, instead of going in the random walk, this particle is now moving in x and y direction. So this is your y direction, this is your x direction, and it's going in a like a straight line. So now you can see if I make the drift for x is equal to 0, then you can see for x it doesn't have a preference, but for y it has a preference. It likes to go to the y side, but in a positive y side, but in the x direction it doesn't bother much. It can go in either way. And again you can see, so in x direction there is no drift, but in y direction there is a drift. So let me put the x's here. Now you can see so you can see that for x there is no preference, but for y it goes to the y side. And if we make this drift less, like suppose 0.4, then instead of going to the 1000, it now goes to the 400. So we can again see it goes to the 400. So it always goes to the 400, but the number, it's not exactly 400 all the time. So now let's make it 0.1. And now it will say that now it goes to the 70s or 80s. And that depends on the random steps it also takes. Sometimes it goes to 90, and sometimes it goes to 110 also. So you can see that the movement is changing. So this is you can also see that if I put 0, then it's completely a random walk. So this is how you add a drift into it. So what is a practical example of a drift? So this is more like, suppose you, again we can go back to the problem of opening a bottle of perfume in the center of the room. So if you open the perfume bottle in the center of the room, the particles should move randomly in all the directions, and slowly the perfume will be uniformly distributed in the room. But if you have a fan, then the fan will push the perfume particles in one direction, so there will be a drift, and that is how you define this drift. So if you have if you increase the speed of the fan, then you can put higher drift. Like if I put 1, then it goes all the way into the Y side, and if I have not that much of power in the fan, then I can say 0.1 and it doesn't go that far, but it still goes in one of the directions. So another example which is more practical is the movement of the stock prices. So basic assumption in the stock prices is that a stock should return a normal risk-free interest rate. So like if you deposit the money you have used for purchasing the stock, if you deposit that money in the bank, then you get a particular result interest rate, and that interest rate is risk-free. So that is considered as a drift in a stock price. So you should always get that much of return on average from a stock. But because of the volatility of the market or the fluctuations, it can also go in the negative direction. So normally, like suppose so normally in that case, the drift is very low, or and the fluctuations are very, very high. So normally you can say, let's do the so instead of looking in the two dimension, let's look into the one dimension. So I just plot the x plot. So this is more of a one dimension movement, because I am plotting only the x here. And now you can compare this. So let me change the data series and say none and line color solid, and then none. So this is more of a simulation of a stock price. So here right now I'm using random number from -1 to 1, but the steps will be defined by the volatility of the stock, and there are some formulas. We can talk about that in the next tutorial, and how to simulate a stock price by using the statistics or the parameters which are available about that stock. But here let's just take an example. So now this is a, if you plot only one dimension, then this is a random walk of a stock, and you can see stock can go up, stock can then go down, and this kind of shapes are not very new. You can look at the Google Finance and look at any kind of stocks, and the movement will almost look like this. It goes up and it goes down. There are some people who also do technical analysis. They call it they try to compare it to the technical trends. This is a resistance, this is a support, but what all it is the random walk. We won't call it exactly random walk, because there is also a thinking process going on, because when a stock price goes really down, then there is no much room for it. The probability of it going down is become less, so people start to buy it. So this that is not completely a random walk in that way, but at least in financial engineering, people use random walk motions to simulate the price of the stock. So here I can add a drift. So if the interest rate is relatively high, suppose we put 1, so interest rates are relatively high as compared to the volatility of the stock. So you can see the stock will go up eventually. and it doesn't matter what the scenario is, most of the stocks will go up because the volatility is not there or much less than the drift. But if the drift is less, that is normally the case in the case of in the normally in the case normally the case for most of the stocks. Then if you have a low drift, so or the drift is much lower as compared to the volatility, then it can go all up or down. Let's try 0.1, and you can see that in this way it goes up, but it's there is a fluctuation. But if you try 0.05, then you can see the movement. Now it still doesn't look much different. Let's try 0.1, and now you can see the drift is almost not there. So now this is the situation of the markets. So you in case of markets, you have much more volatility as compared to the drift, and that's why the stock price changes. So yeah, so we can talk about how to simulate the stock prices in the next tutorial, but right now we want to focus on the Brownian motion, and we can talk more about the Brownian motion in the next tutorial. So I'll see you. Thank you.